Hello, everyone, and welcome to another wonderful episode of Finance with Fernando. I am your host, Fernando de Cunha, a.k.a. the Mortgage Maverick. Please follow me on my Facebook business page at Fernando John de Cunha or via my Instagram business page at Mortgage Maverick. Mortgage is M-O-R-T-G-A-G-E, Maverick, M-A-V-E-R-I-C-K. Today is episode number 8 of the podcast, and I'm actually doing a 3-episode mini-series. This is the first of 3, and today we're going to be discussing a client's income, okay? So how you qualify for a mortgage pertaining to your income, how much money you make, okay? So let's hop into it. So income, pretty straightforward, right? It's how much I make, and whatever... You know, whatever I make is what you're going to show, right? And that's what we're going to qualify you for. I wish it was that simple. I really do. Unfortunately, if you've ever applied for a mortgage and you've been earning cash under the table, not showing taxes, and you've spoken to a mortgage person, you'll know that it's whatever you show the government. It's not what you actually earn. Really unfortunate, but I understand it in the same light because... If the government doesn't get the taxes from you, we can't consider it as actual income. So that being said, what I think is really important to understand is the formula of how lenders calculate your ability to repay. That's what it's called. So whenever you're qualifying for a loan, a lender has to make sure you have the ability to repay the loan. Pretty simple. The formula is, and this is another term that you may have heard, or maybe you haven't heard, is your debt to income ratio. And it's based on your monthly gross income in comparison to your monthly expenses. Pretty simple still, right? So let's say, I always like to use numbers. Let's say you're earning $10,000 gross income. Well, your debt to income ratio is going to be a percentage of that $10,000. Now, if you're applying for a conventional loan, okay, and some previous episodes have mentioned the different types of loans and, you know, what each loan entails, but a conventional loan would be the maximum debt to income ratio of 50%. That's the number is 50. So half of your gross monthly income can be used to qualify you, okay? So what does it mean? So basically, the expenses that you pay per month cannot exceed half of your gross monthly wages, okay? So that 50% includes your mortgage, anything listed on your credit report, which could include your car payments, your installment loans, you know, like a personal loan, student loans, you know, for education, any type of credit cards, you know, anything that is listed on your credit report, as well as your mortgage. And then what most consumers don't realize is within that 50% maximum debt to income ratio, also would take into consideration any expenses you may have that is appointed by the court, meaning your alimony, your child support, things along those lines. Now, you know, most consumers, when they sit down with me initially, and let's say they've gone through a divorce or something, they'll say, well, you know, it's not on my credit report and you're never going to be able to tell. It's not on my bank or it's not on my pay stubs, you know, so how will the underwriter find it? They typically will find it some way, shape or form, but mostly it's from your bank statements, because if it's court appointed, typically it's mandated and it automatically comes out of your bank statements. Sometimes it's listed on your pay stubs as well. So just be aware, the lender will typically find out, and just to have a conversation with your mortgage, you know, your mortgage person, because they'll include that and let you know what the best, you know, plan of attack is. But like I said, so on a conventional loan, if you're making $10,000 gross income per month, the maximum is $5,000 in expenses, and that $5,000 has to include everything. Now, for some other types of loans, like an FHA or a VA loan, FHA stands for Federal Housing Administration, VA stands for Veteran Affairs, you know, to finance homes for our veterans who served our country. you know, the debt to income ratio is higher than 50% currently. So those ratios could go up to 55% or 60%. And they're different from each lender. So certain lenders have their own overlays essentially to protect the client. You know, some lenders are a little more conservative than others. And the reason why I bring this up is, you know, just being someone who advises clients on their liabilities and obtaining debt, I always try and put myself in my client's shoes. And typically what will happen is whenever I consult with a potential client or a client who's buying, if they're looking to get to that higher debt to income ratio. So what I mean by that is like, you know, for example, let's say you're a veteran and you're looking to buy a home and you sit down with a lender and they say, yeah, you could finance, you know, up to 60% of your debt per month. You know, you could qualify 60% in comparison to your gross monthly income. Now that's great and everything, but the problem with that is that you're not taking home your gross monthly income. So if you're making $10,000, you know, per month, you may be walking away with $7,000, something like that, depending on your tax bracket, right? So the issue with that is that if they've approved you with all of your debt on your credit report, your alimony, your child support, and your mortgage payment, stuff like that, and that equals $6,000 out of the $10,000, right? That leaves you $1,000 left over for your cable bill, your cell phone bill, your lifestyle. You know, maybe you want to buy a Starbucks coffee every day for $5 a pop. You know, all of that stuff has to be taken into consideration. So what I tell my clients is, it's not that I'm trying to discourage them from buying, but I want them to be realistic, because that is kind of a jaded view when a consumer gets into a transaction of buying real estate or anything really spectacular for that matter. And I use the term spectacular because buying real estate's a fun thing. You know, it's great. You're buying something that's potentially worth hundreds of thousands of dollars. And it's exciting, right? It's emotional and everyone gets really excited and anxious. Well, the thing is, sometimes that you know, clouds your thoughts. And you don't think through what your lifestyle will be after you close. And I bring that up to my clients, you know, essentially stating to them, just so you know, you don't want to be real estate rich, but I always say money poor, or even change your lifestyle for real estate. You know, if you're typically going on vacation, you know, let's say two times a year, now all of a sudden you can't do that because the majority of your expenses per month are going towards real estate. Maybe you need to either save more and put more money down, maybe buy less of a home, maybe wait, you know, maybe just wait and wait to buy. You know, there's always a perfect time and there's never a perfect time. You know, it's one of those types of situations. A lot of clients turn around and they say to me, well, you know, if like, let's say the income thing comes up and they're like, well, I really, you know, I'm not taking that much home because I put a lot towards my retirement. Well, once again, remember, the formula is for gross income. So they're not taking into consideration the fact that you pay 3% into your 401k or whatever it may be, 403b, you know, for my teacher friends and stuff like that. You know, that's not even in the equation. So then you got to deduct that on top of it as well. You know, so it's something where it has to fit you, and it's really important that you're working with the right professionals that have your interests in mind and not them just making commission, okay? Now, this episode really doesn't get as granular as I would with a client discussing how you're paid, meaning like commission, what type of income we could use if you're self-employed, because there's just too much, you know, to discuss at that point. So if you are interested, we could always do a one-off. But as far as the overall gist of the episode, just keep in mind that for conventional loans, the maximum debt to income ratio is 50%. For FHA and VA, depending on the lender, it could range from 50 to 60%. And once you have that information and you're educated, at least you could kind of do a budget of your monthly expenses and figure out whether buying the home at the point of purchase is right for you. So that's it. I mean, that's income in a nutshell. It's that simple. I say that because I do this every day, but you know, just like I say, you know, like I've mentioned before, educate yourself, be prepared, and be willing to learn. So, you know, there's nothing else on this episode. I will follow up in regards to the other two in the miniseries, which we'll be talking about assets as well as credit. Those are the three characteristics, income, assets, credit, that really make up your approval or denial when, you know, when looking to finance real estate. Feel free to reach out to me with any questions or feedback. And as I've mentioned in many episodes, I'll help you buy your first, next, and last home. Have a great day. Thank you for listening. Bye-bye.